Hello, I stand here today, or I'm not standing, I'm sitting here today in crappy lighting to tell you guys all about this next patron-requested review, which was Voyage of the Shadow Moon, and it was requested by Moritz Fuchs. Actually, now that I'm thinking about it, I think it's supposed to be Moritz Fuchs. But, you know, either way, I read this book, and it was fine.
This is the introduction song. It's not very good, but it's not too long.
If you missed the last one of these I did, basically, I'm not doing patron-requested reviews anymore, at least until I can think of a new way to do them, so I only had three more to do, and this is number two. So after this, there'll only be one more. If you want more detail, watch the Eye of the Oracle review. But basically, Voyage of the Shadow Moon is, well, it sounds kind of like a regular epic fantasy story on paper, and in a lot of ways it is. It's basically just, okay, a band of adventurers go off on a quest to stop some sort of major evil dude. Like, in this case, it's basically just this emperor who wants to conquer basically everything and who has this crazy powerful magical weapon that'll allow him to do it. And the main thing that sets it apart, at least a little bit, is that this one is more ocean-focused. Like, I'm not sure what the name for this subgenre would be, like pirate fantasy or something like that. But rather than being mostly, you know, people on land doing land-based adventures, it's people on a ship who are, you know, they're very experienced sailors, and it's mostly about them sailing from place to place. And it's nautical-themed, nautical-focused, however you want to put that. And so it does give the setting, at the very least, a little bit of a different feeling to it, which, as someone who hasn't read a whole lot of, again, I don't know what you'd call it, but pirate fantasy is what I'm going to call it for now. But as someone who hasn't read a whole lot of that, yeah, it was kind of nice to get something that was at least a little bit different. And beyond that, I think that this book is fine. You know, it's it doesn't have a whole lot in there that really stuck out to me all that much. Like, I read it and enjoyed it. It was fine. It was all right. But I don't have all that much to talk about, really. So an issue that I have is that the beginning kind of falls into the trap of starting off with a bang in that you start off with an action scene. Now, it could be a lot worse, because I have seen much worse examples of that, where it's just like, oh, this person swung sword, this other guy swung sword, and then gun go off, and someone shot. And the problem with that, at least in book form, is that I don't know these people, and I don't know what they're fighting about, so I don't really care that much. And I've seen worse examples than in this, because in this, it's basically starts off with, there's a city that's under siege, it's been under siege for a little while, and then there's like a big battle to finish it off. But it doesn't focus on the fighting itself too much, so much as, like, the people who are in command of one side of the fighting, and why exactly they're doing this, and what led up to this moment. And then the final destruction of the city, or not destruction per se, but the final victory that they achieve, let's say. So while, yes, I still didn't care all that much about what was going on at this point in time, and so while this is a big dramatic moment that, had it come later in the story, would probably have had my attention a little more, it's still not too awful here. You know, I've seen so much worse than that, and at the very least, it does start things off pretty quickly, so other people might be more into that, I don't know. And as for the main ship that most of the characters travel on, the Shadow Moon, I think that's also pretty fun. You know, it's like, at first it seems like, oh, okay, it's just some regular, old, nondescript ship that no one really cares about. It's really small, so it can't carry that much cargo or that many passengers. It doesn't move that fast, so like no one cares about it. But then as the story goes on, you learn, oh, okay, it's actually much more advanced than that. And even though the crew is small, they are all at least a little unique in terms of characterization. Like, the captain is kind of his own thing, and then pretty early on they bring in a passenger by the name of Laron, I think that's how you're supposed to say it, and he, I've seen this trope done before, but I still really like it. He is a vampire who's been around for hundreds of years, but he still looks like he's a 14-year-old boy because he was turned when he was very young. And, you know, I've seen that before. Like, in Interview with a Vampire, Kirsten Dunst's character was, you know, she looked like a little girl, but she was actually much older than that. Or in Skyrim, there was that, I want to say her name was Babette, I don't remember though, and she was a vampire who was turned when she was 10 years old, but she was over 200 by the time the game starts. And I don't know why, but something about that is just really cool to me. Like, this body that looks like it should belong to someone, well, you know, who's a child, they're innocent, but they're clearly not, you know, they're vampires, they fucking kill people. I don't know, I really like that, and I think that's cool. And, you know, we have a couple other characters like that on there, and they're all fun. You know, they all have a little bit of personality to them. I remember at least something about all of them. That was kind of cool. I have kind of the same issue with this that I had with Zenith. It's not to the same extent, but if you remember my review of that a few months ago, in that one, I was a little upset that there were only 4 members of the crew, because part of the fun of having a ship like this is in stuff like, say, Mass Effect or Firefly, where there's a much bigger cast, and they all, again, have their own personalities, they have their own goals and dreams, they have their own, in some cases, they have their own unique ways of fighting, or you can also look at the relationships between all of them, which is pretty cool when it's done right. Like, having a bigger crew allows for more of that, and in this, we only have a couple of characters, so that was a little disappointing, but, you know, not too big a deal. I also thought that the villain, the Emperor Warsovran, something like that, I thought he was kind of fun. You know, he's kind of just an evil dude who's doing evil stuff because he's evil, but he had a neat backstory. I enjoyed watching him have to not only just be this evil guy who sends his armies at the main characters, but he also has to deal with some political intrigue on his side and having to keep his allies in check and avoid being stabbed in the back by his wife. You know, that was all kind of fun. I enjoyed that. And it's rare for political intrigue and political maneuvering stuff to be done well, especially in fantasy for some reason. Like, I don't know what it is, but they're just, most fantasy authors are not particularly good at that, which is usually fine when it's not focused on too much, but sometimes they focus on it way too much. Like, well, like, the back half of Wheel of Time is a good example. They spend a shitload of time on that, and it just feels like, yeah, I don't want to get into that. But basically, all the political maneuvering stuff in here, that was fun. I enjoyed it. And, you know, I just don't have that much specific to say about this. You know, like the world is kind of fun. You know, it's fine. It has a little bit of a different feel to it than most other worlds I read about, because, again, it's nautical flavored, but it doesn't stand out all that much. It's still kind of like, oh yeah, fantasy world. The characters, I remember some of them pretty well. There's a bunch that kind of fade into the background because this has a relatively large cast, which is unfortunate, but you know, it does happen. And I remember a couple though, and those were good. You know, the way this book is paced and the storyline and all that is good. The actual prose, the writing of it is good. And it's kind of a simple read, is the thing. Like, there's only so much detail I can go into regarding why I liked it. And, well, yeah, I just don't have that much else to say. This is a fairly long book, so if you're just expecting a quick, like, oh, this would be a little swashbuckling adventure, like, no, it's not that. You're not going to get that. Like, this is trying to be epic fantasy in a lot of ways, so it is fairly long. But I did get through it relatively quick, so I don't know, just keep all that in mind if you decide to check this one out. I'd recommend at least reading, like, some sample chapters on Amazon or something, if it sounds like something that might pique your interest. And if not, then your reading it's probably not going to change your mind. But overall, yeah, Voyage of the Shadow Moon, I thought it was alright. I enjoyed myself.
Special thanks to all the names you see here. These are all my patrons, and especially thanks to my $10 and up patrons, Apo Savalainen, Olivia Rand, Brother Santodis, Carolina Clay, Christopher Quinten, Echo, Great Grebo, Joel, Carcat Kitsune, K.R. Stevenson, Liza Rudakova, Lord Tiebreaker, Madison Lewis Bennett, Micaphone, Moritz Fuchs, Sad Mardigan, Samuel Nevin, Tobacco Crow, Tom Beanie, and Vae Victus, as well as, you know, everyone who's watched this far. If you want to get your name on here or get access to stuff like early access to my videos and voting on what topic I'll cover next, then consider becoming a patron. If you don't want to do that, then you could also just subscribe and like this video and share it around or become a YouTube channel member. Really, there's a lot of things you could be doing to make my life better, and that's really what this is all about. It's all about what you can do for me, so get on that. Bye.